senior members of the IMA for knockouts. I'm thankful to the chairperson for this opportunity. Though my topic about a rare condition comes in the wake of the initiation given by my general practitioner, who referred a case of leaving ER 2 months back. She was a weak lady, diabetic lady, and I diagnosed that rectal pollen. I went surgery for her. She didn't turn up after for 2 months. After 2 months, she came for surgery, and I did a polypectomy. I found something fishy in that pollen, and I said, maybe malignant, but the biopsy report came as melanoma. So just to highlight, you know, what is melanoma of the anal canal, though it is a very rare condition, I'm just here to talk about this condition. So this is about the anatomy of the anal canal, which everybody knows that there is a perfect landmark that is called the dentate line. The dentate line represents the junction of the rectal mucosa with the anal canal skin. And you have no melanocytes in the rectum, that is in the rectal mucosa, but you can get a polyp which can have melanoma. So this is always a query. But below the dentate line, you are bound to have the normal skin, which has melanin producing melanocytes. Therefore, melanoma is quite common there. It can occur in that area. So, as you said, the origin of melanoma in the rectum is always controversial. People don't know how they arise. And one postulation is that it arises from the stratified stratus epithelium, which is just above the dentate line. And this has no role with the UV radiation. But generally, there are some risk factors for melanoma to develop in any part of our body. As shown, the nevi can develop into melanomas, freckles in the skin, and then severe sunburn. And if there is a family history of malignant melanoma, then also you can get melanoma. So this is about the effect of the UV radiation above the sea level. Now you can see that if it is about 9,000 feet above the sea level, the UV radiation effect is 45%. And if it is 6,000, it is only 30%. Regarding the family history, there is a connection of this gene, which is mentioned here as CDKN2A, which is on the chromosome 9. If this particular gene is there, and these people are bound to inherit the melanoma. And some of these people, as you can see, some rectal are using this sun protective cream. This is actually a false sense of security. Nevi, the other name for nevi is just ordinary mole, that is, moles are present at birth. And normally these melanocytes aggregate and produce the mole. They can be present at birth or they can present at puberty. So the types of nevi are 23. Junctional nevi, compound nevi, and dermal nevi. That is, everybody knows that there is an epidermis, dermis, and then subcutaneous tissue. And if the nevus lies along the epidermal-dermal junction, it is called a junctional nevus. And if it invades into the dermis, it is called a compound nevus. If it is totally inside the dermis, it is called dermal. So there is a condition known as hyperplasia of melanocytes. This need not be confused with melanoma. So there is a cavity known as dysplastic nevi. Dysplasia means D, always stands for danger. These dysplastic nevi can become malignant. Therefore, it is important to know about these dysplastic nevi. There is always a growth pattern of melanoma, which is either it grows either vertically or in the circumferential manner. If it grows vertically, it grows into the dermis, and if it is monophasic, it grows rapidly. There are 4 or 5 types of melanoma. As we have seen, that the commonest is the superficial spreading melanoma, which is commonest. Then comes the nodular melanoma, and then atrial lentiginous melanoma, lentigo malignant melanoma, and the mucosal melanoma. So this is about a picture of all the types of melanomas. It's not connected with this actually rectum anal canal, but just generally I am showing all these slides. In the front is the common type. The atrial lentiginous melanoma occurs always in the limbs. This is a subungual melanoma, which can resemble the hematoma under the nail fold. There is another entity known as amelanotic melanoma, which does not contain any melanin pigment, but still it is called an amelanotic melanoma, which is missed always clinically. The aids in the clinical diagnosis of melanoma, how to say that a mole is becoming a melanoma, these are the guidelines given by the Glasgow system on the left side and the American ABCDE system on the right side. But these are the things that we should look for in a mole to say that there is possibly a change in the mole which becomes a melanoma, that is change in the size. Irregular pigmentation, irregular outline, and the diameter which is more than 6 millimeters, inflammation, oozing, bleeding, and itching. Now, coming to the rectum and anal canal melanomas, the patient can present with any of these symptoms like anal bleeding, anal pain and discomfort, perianal itching and irritation, some mass coming down, and perianal discharge. Now the differential diagnosis for this condition, which a general practitioner can make a mistake, is a perianal hematoma, a thrombosed pile, endorectal polyp, as in my case, a blackish mass protruding per annum, bleeding appear with tenesmus, and the perianal pruritus alone. This is looking like a thrombosed pile mass, but it is only a melanoma. Now this is a case of rectal polyp, which looks like an ordinary polyp, and when you go advanced into the colon, you can see some melanotic pigments far beyond the lesion. Depending on the thickness of the melanoma, Clark has designed. Now, this is the staging of melanoma is designed by Breslow. As he has said, below 0.76 millimeters, it is thin, and between 0.76 to 1.49 it is intermediate, and the next is up to 4, and beyond 4 it is thick. breast flow thickness is the most important prognostic criteria. The staging as per Clark is level 1 is in situ at the basement membrane, level 2 is through the basement membrane into the papillary dermis, level 3 is spread to the papillary reticular interface, level 4 is spread to the reticular dermis, level 5 is subcutaneous invasion. There is a complicated staging which you do not remember. Now just work up of any case of melanoma, this is general for all the melanoma of all other sites. Regarding this particular case, you know, anywhere there is a node suspicious of a secondary deposit, you must take an FNAC, MRI if it is needed, PET-CT in advanced cases, LDH particularly if you suspect liver metastasis, and a biopsy of the lesion has to be including the subcutaneous fat. It should always include the subcutaneous fat, and if you are not able to make an excision of that tumor, you do an incisional biopsy. And after taking the specimen, this is the most important step that you have to make to say that there is melanoma. That is the immunocytochemistry or the immunohistochemistry, of which S100 is the most sensitive tumor marker. If it is positive, then it is 100% melanoma. So if you want to differentiate a benign melanoma from a malignant one, you need another tumor marker, which is Ki-67. There are also other tumor markers like HMD45, MART, Melan-A, tyrosinase. They are also may be elevated. Now, what is the role of a PET scan in melanoma? Simply can say that PET scan is very useful in melanoma. It is not like that because it has got certain limitations. It cannot detect micro metastasis within the lungs. Now, there are some indications, as I have shown in the slide, where you can subject a patient for PET scan. As I said, the prognosis of melanoma depends mainly on the thickness of the lesion as per the Breslow's grading. Women generally respond better to treatment than men. Any melanoma anywhere in the body, the recommended margin as shown here, if it is less than 1 millimeter, then it should be 1 centimeter. If it is 1 to 4 millimeter, then 2 centimeter. If it is more than 4 millimeter, then 3 centimeters. All depths up to the underlying deep fascia. Deep fascia has to be included in the excision. Now, in this particular case of colorectal melanoma, there is always a debate between two questions. That is, one, is it enough to do a wide local excision and then come out? Or is it wise to do an APR and then get a response? Now, the answer is both have the same result. Even if you do an APR, the patient is going to die. Because this is the worst condition you can get, worst malignancy you can get in the anus, is a melanoma of the anus. Whatever way you treat the patient, they will develop metastasis in the liver, lung, bone, everywhere within few months or years. 1 or 2 years. Now this is about the advanced disease which my friend the Srinivasan, if he is here, able to tell all these chemotherapeutic agents have been tried. As I said, the survival rate depends on the stage of the disease. Now in India, we are not able to diagnose melanoma so early as the final diagnosing in the clerk level or in the breast level. We get patients only when they are fairly advanced. And the lymph nodal clearance, as I said, does not have any bearing on the outcome. Zelcora is some promising in the metastatic melanoma. Thank you.